Βίος και Πολιτεία του Αλέξη Ζορμπά in 1943. After the war, the book was translated into many languages and won the prize of Best Foreign Work in France in 1954. This fictionalized recollection of Kazantzakis' ventures with Georgis Zorbas many years earlier became, of course, our author's blockbuster success, eventually after its well-known Oscar-winning 1964 cinematic rendition. Zorba the Greek, by Cypriot director Michalis Kakogiannis, with Mexican-American star Anthony Quinn in the eponymous role, became, fairly or not, emblematic of Greeks heard everywhere, including its music, the iconic Sirtaki dance composed by the patriarch of Greek music composers, Mikis Theodorakis, now in his 90s. Even though Kazantzakis started some of his other novels during his World War II years at Aegina, as the war was coming to a close with uncertain consequences for the political unity of a post-war Greece, he felt the need to once again make the leap from the world of words to the world of political action. To that end, in early 1945, he became leader of a small party, the Socialist Labor Union, in a futile effort to promote unity in a country increasingly torn apart by civil strife between the right and left factions. In this capacity, he chaired a committee that visited Crete in the summer of that year so as to record the German atrocities and destruction that had taken place there during the war. Interestingly, the poignant report that came out of that work was never published by the Greek government. Later that year, he was sworn in as a minister without portfolio in the cabinet of the short-lived National Unity Government of Themistocles Sophoulis. However, he resigned within a couple of months, apparently recognizing his inability to positively impact Greece during these partisan times. An additional disappointment was the rejection of his candidacy for membership at the Academy of Athens, even though he was already the president of the Union of Greek Writers, Enosi Ellinon Logotechnon, likely due to his being perceived as a communist sympathizer, and despite his well-documented disillusionment with the practices of the Stalin regime in the Soviet Union. After these debacles, and with the civil war raging in Greece in 1946, Kazantzakis left on a trip to England, invited by the British Council. However, Cold War sensitivities followed him there. During an interview in which he challenged the officially accepted figure of the size of the communist sympathizers in Greece, 9.3% versus 30%, he was deemed undesirable by the Foreign Office and had to decamp to France. In France, the Greek embassy declined to renew his Greek passport, essentially forbidding him from re-entering his country. Thus, Kazantzakis never returned to Greece, simply settling with Eleni, his Lenotska, in southern France at a modest house in the seaside town of Antibes, the ancient Antipolis near Nice. His home there, the cocoon, Kukuli, became the basis for the last 11 years of his life. And creative cocoon it proved to be. The years in Antibes were very fruitful for his relaxed novel writing. Besides Alexis Zorbas, six novels saw the light of day during that time, all of them important works that became major milestones of Greek and world literature. In 1948 came Christ the Crucified, the story of a Greek village in Asia Minor where a reenactment of the Passion of Christ is being planned. The arrival of a group of refugees perturbs the village's life and compels the young Manolios, whom we saw a little bit earlier, chosen for the role of Christ in the reenactment, to grasp the real meaning of the Christian religion and trying to apply it, to come into conflict with the village's priests and elders and to encounter a violent death inside the church. The book became a major success around the world, and it inspired various memorable adaptations, of which we will mention three. The first one, shortly before the author's death in 1957, was as a major French movie entitled Celui qui doit mourir, He Who Must Die, by another 50s exile from his homeland. American director Jules Dassin, and including Dassin's wife, the famous Greek star Melina Mercouri, in a starring role. The second one, shortly thereafter, was as Greek Passion, an opera in four acts by Czech composer Bohuslav Martinů, one of the prolific and reclusive composer's most important works. And the third one was as a major TV series by Hellenic Public Broadcasting in 1975-76, the organization's first major ambitious undertaking, and a major success, as many in the audience may recall. And talking about recollection, comes the time of the quiz. Here's a quiz for our Kazantzakis aficionados in the audience. Which iconic Greek actor played the exact same role in the French movie and Greek TV adaptations of Christ the Crucified? Answer will be given at the reception after this presentation. After Christ the Crucified, Kazantzakis published Kapetan Michalis, the semi-biographical adaptation of the life of his father, set in the Cretan Revolution of 1889 at the Heraklion of the author's childhood. This is an important book, best described as heroic pessimism, which is presented through a series of contrasting pairs: Cretans, Turks, man, woman, intellectual, warrior, love, war, obedience, revolution. The book, often translated as Freedom or Death, was adapted into a memorable theatrical play in 1966, starring Manos Katrakis, with music by none other than the other sacred giant of modern Greek music, Manos Katsidakis. Here's a musical expert. The song, Pou Inei o Theos, Where is the God? Sung by then 19-year-old Giorgos Romanos.
Thank you.
Next, Kazantzakis finished his other major novel, the far more controversial and influential Ο Τελευταίος Πειρασμός, The Last Temptation of Christ. With this novel, Kazantzakis brilliantly established a new kind of religious storytelling, one in which the evangelical narration is presented from Jesus' own perspective or is reinterpreted by using elements from the Gnostic Gospels and the mythological traditions of the Eastern Mediterranean. In the novel, Jesus is presented as a simple carpenter, selected by God for the mission of human salvation. In the beginning, he refuses insistently, but eventually obeys the divine will. During the crucifixion, he experiences in a vision how his life would have been had God not allowed him to be sacrificed. 3 decades after the author's passing, the 1988 blockbuster movie by Martin Scorsese, with young Willem Dafoe as Jesus and music by Peter Gabriel, captured brilliantly the book's spirit, as shown in this brief mashup.